Welcome, welcome very, very much to Conversation. It's a pleasure to welcome to the program John Tarleton, and he's the editor of a publication that's here in New York that he's had a hand in using. It's called The Indypendent, and we're going to be talking with him about that. It's a major publication that I think a number of the people would be very interested in knowing about. And John, welcome so very, very much to Conversation.
Thank you, Harold. It's great to be here with you again.
We met, how long ago was it we met when you were working at the Indypendent then? But it was back in 2009, I think, we did a program.
Yeah, I think we chatted about 10 years ago.
Wow, you were just getting started there, yeah. Yep. With the newspaper, yeah?
Mm-hmm. Well, the paper's was started in the fall of 2000, so it's actually 16 years old now, but we were, you know, it's been a steady process, so
yeah,
well, lot's happened since we talked
last. Congratulations on that, yeah. Incidentally. That's good that you've been able to do that. Okay, tell me about yourself. Where were you born and raised? And then we're going to talk about, if we're on ground a little bit, and you, if you could, please. You were out of Texas, I understand?
I was born in Houston, Texas.
Mm-hmm.
Both my mother and father encouraged us to pay attention to current events, to be aware of history. And we had a lot of good discussions around the dinner table.
Yeah,
you
right.
know, Walter Cronkite was
yes,
always on
right.
the
he was
television
a, yeah.
right before dinner time, and
uh-huh.
you know, he had copies of Time or U.S. News and World Reporter, you
yeah.
know, lying around, and so and we had a subscription to the Houston Post, the morning newspaper. So we were encouraged to be. You know, to pay attention to what was going on in the world.
Yeah.
And,
Your dad was a lawyer, I think you said, right?
He was.
Yeah. Uh-huh, uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. He did. He was in the civil service for the federal government for a while, and then
uh-huh.
he went on to do his own criminal defense practice.
Yeah, I see. Okay.
And the
family was encouraging intellectually and so forth, and friendly,
yeah, so we
and warm, and everything.
Yeah, and we always had lots of books, and were yeah. encouraged to read, and
yeah.
Yeah, so I was really fortunate in that way.
We use a term, you and I have even come upon it individually, of an autodidact. There's somebody who just learns as they live. They're not put it according to some formula that you have to learn this and learn that in an educational sense, but they're just interested in learning as at the get-go and so forth. Would it be fair to say you would be an autodidact? I think it's a very honorable quality.
Sure, I think as a journalist, I mean,
yeah.
you're almost the, you know, the essence of it is to live curiously
yeah.
and have many questions and always want to be learning new things from the people you meet as the research you do. And
right.
So uh-huh. I would, on some level, I think almost all journalists are autodidacts. And that's probably would describe me as well.
Yeah, I think it is. And also there's a thing, systems understanding, rather than specialization, interested in a lot of different things and the connection between various fields.
Yes.
Interaction at the interface is a term that came up back in the days of Woodstock and so forth a lot, you know?
Yeah, no, I mean, with the Indypendent and the kind of journalism we've done over
yeah.
the years, we definitely try to, you know, connect the dots, as I say, and,
yeah.
and be able to place news and current events in a historical context, in
right.
a political context, a social context, and that requires thinking systematically,
yeah.
not in a, you know, overly narrow
manner.
That's
very good. Systematic thinking it turns into systems thinking too. And I think it would be good to have some of that around rather than just highly specialized things that become part of journals within the media, within the industries and so forth, or people that have an interest that way. Anyway, that's very interesting, and I
yeah.
know it was that long ago that we met, and you were just then, you were here in New York,
mm-hmm.
and we did a program with you. We're going to try and dig that out as
okay.
an old format and so forth. But you were involved with the Indypendent then,
mm-hmm.
and maybe we could get over to the Indypendent itself. It's a major, major newspaper and journalistic effort, if I may say so,
okay.
in terms particularly for people who are of a progressive
mm-hmm.
frame of mind,
mm-hmm.
okay, and everything. But how did it get started? Were you involved at the start of it? And maybe you could, the birth of the Indypendent as a newspaper, I think destined to become widely known and widely reporting on things that are of interest to the broader society than it has been. But what was the start of it, if you could?
Sure. The The Indypendent actually emerged out of a media movement called Indie Media.
Okay, yeah.
Indie Media, which began at the Seattle WTO protests in November 1999. It was intended to be a one-week website to provide sort of a grassroots perspective on those protests, which turned out to be historic and very high impact. And
It was a major moment, right?
Yes, and that website had some unique features that allowed people to be able to share their own stories, their own photos, their own video on the website in real time in a way that didn't exist at that point in the development of the internet. It was a very new development. It was sort of one of the first examples of crowdsourced journalism, and it was a very popular website, and people all over the world who were following the Seattle WTO protests and were following indie media reporting from Seattle realized that they wanted to start indie media centers in their own cities to chronicle, protests and other social movement activity. So indie media quickly spread to dozens of cities around the world, around the United States. It later grew over the next several years to around 200 cities around the world. And the New York chapter started about 9 months later, and a lot of the credit for initially getting things rolling goes to a woman named Anna Noguera. She had worked on a college paper at SUNY Purchase and was a couple of years out of school, and she got a small grant to be able to start publishing a paper through New York Indie Media, and so that first issue came out in the fall of 2000, and Anna recruited myself and some other people very early on to really help pull this thing together and carry it forward. And the first issue was 4 pages, all black and white.
Was it mimeographed? I can remember back, we used to do it with a mimeograph by hand back in the old days.
It wasn't quite mimeographed, it did look pretty, a little rough around the edges.
Yeah, right. Uh-huh.
And, but, we learned
it was done lovingly.
Yes.
And with commitment and genuine, not, they weren't Howard hired hands or something like that.
No, everybody who was involved was doing it, out of passion and commitment.
Also, for people on the progressive side of things and everything, there's been a great deal of reason to be disappointed in the way the political leaders of the country have been operating, or the world. Uh-huh. And that thing in Seattle was a major moment of breakthrough or a sense of achievement on the part of the progressive forces that had been given short shrift.
Yes.
Over the longer haul, I think it was a moment of breakthrough in terms of hey, maybe we can really get something going here toward these goals that we've had that have been roundly ignored by the political establishment and that sort of thing, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, it was a big moment. Yeah. And I think it planted some seeds that also, later took hold of in Occupy, for example, over a decade later.
Yeah, that's way down.
Yeah,
into the future. Yeah.
Yeah, it was a big moment. I think it was somewhat got submerged when 9/11 happened in the the whole war on terror. But I think the underlying issues that came up in Seattle, people's estrangement from the government, from the sense that corporations have way too much power in our country. I think those continue to be very relevant issues today, and I think people, I think everybody who was there had an impact. I was there myself, and it was a very powerful experience to be there. And that I think is what gave a lot of energy to this to indie media, this sort of global collaboration of grassroots media makers. And here in New York, what we wanted to do, we didn't want to just do a website, because sometimes the audience for a readership for a website can be self-selecting, and we wanted to also publish a newspaper and be able to reach a larger swath of people.
Right.
And there's just some things also about a newspaper that are very unique that continue to be very valuable even in the era of the internet, in terms of being able to hand people a full package of material that they can carry with them anywhere.
Absolutely.
That they can share with other people, they can curl up with on the couch or read on the subway. And so the paper has been well received by our readers, and we've been able to steadily grow over time, and we didn't have a lot of resources to start with, so often in publishing the model is a publisher will have millions of dollars from investors.
Yes, right.
And basically they
lots of bureaucracy.
Yeah, they burn, you know, yeah. The idea is, well, you're gonna burn through millions of dollars and hopefully you build up a readership and can sell enough ads to become financially sustainable. We started with a $500 grant. We had to do our own fundraising, and you know, we learned a lot from that, so we've had to, you know, grow steadily and organically, but we're, you know, we're still here. And
you do,
still
and growing. The writing and the presentation is so good.
Thank you. It is
high class, good journalism that you're doing, and you're covering the issues in a very, very interesting way.
Yes.
And I'm really overwhelmingly impressed with how good the product is that you're an editor of. You have a team of people there.
Yes.
And you said it come out of India Media. Was that something, fill me in on that. That was coming out of the, there were other things going on around the country and everything out of Seattle, or the India Media movement. You grew out of that? You're part of that? Is it still there? Or where does it fit in with what you're doing?
Yeah,
Or you fit in with what it is part of.
Right.
Indie
Media probably peaked from about Indie Media was sort of this global, almost federation of grassroots media projects that all had local websites that were folded into this larger network, and then each of the local groups that had a website, they also sometimes pursued other projects at a local level.
Mm-hmm.
Some did. Internet radio shows, video, and in New York, when we started, we had a website. We also had a newspaper. We wanted to do a newspaper. We also had some people who were doing an internet radio show for a while, and had some people doing some video production. And I mean, the newspaper was the project that sort of had the most staying power and really took off over time.
You think it grew out of the success of the Seattle effort?
Well,
it gave an incentive to.
The creation of the network, it became a magnet for all sorts of, left-leaning journalists and media activists who were looking for a place to do good work. So that was, I guess, what sort of helped give it an initial push. But then, I mean, our success here in New York has largely been due to, different things that we've done on the ground and to make the paper viable.
You've been part of that.
Yes.
And then you've got that, and your journalistic was that. Are other things that being as well in terms of putting together a newspaper as good as the one you've done happening in, I don't know, San Francisco and in Boston and other things, or you're carrying the ball in an interesting way? And one other thing, you said there was a sense of breakthrough for progressive, but we're in the middle of an election. In fact, there's going to be a big election between Mr. Trump and Mrs. Clinton and everything.
Uh-huh.
And I note that one of the things they say is that it's not only just the left that is really a potential audience for talking about something new.
Sure.
It's getting into where it's almost permeating the whole society.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that sense of discontent or something's wrong, we need something else, is very much more widespread than just a few people on the left or even a few on the right, as it was. It's almost permeating the whole society now, it seems to me. I don't know if it does that way to you. Maybe it's co-ed a little bit.
Yeah, sure. Like, maybe you look at
you were harbingers of something that was coming and growing and becoming more relevant all the time.
Yes. I mean, since the founding
to greater numbers of people. I'm sorry. Yeah.
No, if you look since the founding of our paper, since then, I mean, we've had, two recessions, including the financial crash of 2008.
Yeah.
Bogus wars started
on
false pretexts. The 1% really running off with most of the new wealth of our society. So I think all that has led people to feel that the political system is unresponsive, corrupt, rigged against them. That was something that Bernie Sanders was able to speak to.
Yeah,
I mean,
right.
Trump is speaking to it in a certain way in a very
crude
and really tapping into the worst impulses of people.
Yeah,
Sanders was trying to really offer a reconstructive vision of how we could, you know, move forward in a way that would lift people up.
Well, Saunders had been from his youth one of us. If we were talking about radical thinking, a left radical thinking, progressive or something like that. But I really think it's becoming more and more, that is permeating the society in general, at the point I'm trying to make.
Yes, and wonder, and that's, you know, with our paper, like something we've always tried to keep in mind with each article we write, the headlines, the how we design it, is to try to make it accessible for people who don't already think of themselves as activists, but maybe, you know, curious about why things are going the way they are, who are at least open to hearing a different perspective. So we try to, you know, respect readers in that way, to produce material that doesn't talk down to them, that doesn't try to beat them over the head to make them feel like we're trying to drag them into feeling a certain way. We try to present the information. We we bring a different perspective, but we do real reporting. Accuracy is very important to us. So all these sort of traditional journalistic tools we respect, but at the same time, you know, we do try to bring in a deeper sense of history and politics and economics, so that so that we can sort of slice through a lot of the sort of cliches that dominate coverage of politics and society.
Yeah,
well,
I want to ask you something as a non-informed, not as informed. I've heard something that's in the society, and it's sort of that something about the 62 people. You've heard that, the thing that's floating around in the society in all circles now. That I wondered if you could fact check out on it or something like that. 62 people have the wealth that's equal to half the population of the world in this in this country. Have you heard that figure?
I've heard various figures. I mean, I've heard it
it's
being
staggering.
a few
it's
hundred
staggering.
People. Like whether it, whether it's
62. They
yes,
62. I guess they could give you chapter and verse who they are and so forth.
Sure.
But you understand how concentrated the wealth has become. In a way that just obviates so much of the thinking about universal justice or what we need to have for social order.
Sure. I mean, the Walton family alone is worth roughly $140 billion. Bill Gates is, I think, net worth is around $65 billion. Zuckerberg at Facebook is worth many billions now, and there's others like them. And sure, many people in the world, you know, are trying to survive on, you know, $1, $2, $3 a day. So there is a tremendous...
Right.
Disparities that have become much more dramatic, extreme in the last 30, 40 years. And I mean, some people would argue that's how, you know, capitalism tends to function. If there's not an intervention by popular movements, by governments responding to the needs of their people, wealth will tend to become highly polarized. And then once you have extreme disparities in wealth, then can be used to manipulate the political process, where the very wealthy buy and control the politicians.
So there's a sense of, I don't know, free-floating angst or something that's permeating the society at large. It seems to me, in a way that hadn't been the case in the past, it was given over to some academics or people who wrote books of blockbusters about this and that and everything, but it's just permeating the whole society. Your newspaper is magnificent, if I say so. It's so well put together. The artwork is good. The writing is good. It's well fact-checked and everything like that.
Thank you.
And you're distributing it here in New York, by and large. Mm-hmm. We're here at Manhattan Neighborhood Network.
Yes.
We're very proud and happy to have it here.
We always leave some copies here.
Yeah, they're here. And you do it in other places like that.
Yes.
So talk a little bit about the... A little bit more. I think you're located out with the Brooklyn Commons now.
Yes.
A really good location where, if I'm not mistaken, WBAI is there also.
There's a...
And other radically inclined institutions are associated with
There's a number of outstanding progressive organizations that are tenants at the Commons. Ourselves, WBAI, Jacobin Magazine, Right to the City, Fury. The Marxist Education Project.
Uh-huh.
So some really great groups to be in the same space with. I mean, our original offices were in Manhattan. Eventually, like many individuals and organizations, got priced out of Manhattan. But we're thrilled that we landed at the Commons about 3 years ago.
Yeah.
and are working from there.
There's a whole lot of energy on that street. That's on Atlantic Avenue.
Yeah, we're on Atlantic.
388 Atlantic Avenue,
yes.
to be exact.
Yes.
And that's a major source of good stuff being done, including BAI and so forth.
Yeah, there is. And so, yeah, we're you know, really fortunate that we were able to land there. I mean, mm-hmm. you know, real estate and is challenging here in New York for,
yeah, sure,
for groups
yeah.
that don't have enormous resources at their disposal.
You've put it together very, very well. Now, is there, you also put it out on the line, online, right?
Yes.
It's available online. And how is that going? How is the distribution
yeah.
working out? And is it being picked up in other parts of the country, either online or is there hard copy delivered anywhere else around the country other than here in Manhattan? Could there be?
Uh-huh.
Could there be outreach of it? It seems to me it would have an audience in many, many places across the country with the quality that you're putting out. And I wonder if there any thought about being able to expand the distribution within reasonable terms to other parts of the country or not, or what's the outlook
well,
for that?
We are expanding our circulation.
Mm-hmm.
Our print circulation is mainly based here in New York City. It is a city of 8 million people, so there's.
That's true. It's an institution in itself.
So,
yes, yes,
and,
indeed.
And a fair amount of our coverage is rooted in the city. I mean, we cover both local city issues as well as larger issues that extend beyond New York. But
mm-hmm.
There's definitely a New York flavor to the paper. It is a city of 8.4 million people.
Yeah.
You know, so we do try to we circulate in Manhattan, Brooklyn, parts of Queens, and the Bronx, and as far as outside of the city,
uh-huh.
I mean, we have subscribers that from outside the city that we
for hard copy.
Yeah,
hard
people.
Copy?
Yeah, people
mail it in the mail, like
yeah.
Reader's Digest used to come, right?
Right. Yeah,
yeah,
people, you know,
yeah.
$25 a year, they get
yeah,
a subscription,
yeah.
and
yeah.
we mail it out every issue.
Uh-huh.
But the larger amount of people from outside of New York who would see the paper would see it online
mm-hmm.
At our website, indypendent.org.
It's all available online.
Yeah, we share
yeah,
it all
yeah.
online.
Okay.
There's
that's
no,
a wondrous thing, isn't it?
There's no paywall. No paywall
yeah.
For us. You know, our mission from the beginning has always been to try to, get it out as widely as possible. So through our website,
mm-hmm.
All the articles go up on the website.
Right.
The PDF of the
yeah.
whole issue goes
right.
up on the
uh-huh.
site. We also are active on, you know, with Facebook, Twitter, Instagram.
Yeah, those are all other ways of getting things out.
Yes,
yeah,
we
yeah,
share
right.
we share our content on there, and also, you know, between issues,
because mm-hmm.
We publish monthly, but between issues, we also publish original articles on our website, and then
mm-hmm.
and then disseminate it through social media, through
yeah.
Facebook, Twitter, et cetera.
Uh-huh.
Also, our articles are sometimes picked up by other sort of lefty aggregator. Sites like Truth Out.
Truth Out's magnificent.
Yeah,
they work with our Wolf. Richard Wolf works
yes.
with Truth Out.
Yes.
He's putting out major analysis of economics. He's,
yes.
he's at the New School or was and so forth. Or
yeah.
but he's also a major source. What he contributes or does he or has?
He's written a few articles for us over the years.
He's a major resource. I mean, and there are some people in academia.
Uh-huh.
Do you find that there's people in academia or political science departments or something around the country that might be, it might be just a little bit of a trickle now of people subscribing to it and wanting
mm-hmm.
to have it?
Uh-huh.
Because what other journals are there? I mean, there's a lot available on the internet
uh-huh.
with Twitter and that kind of stuff
uh-huh.
and everything. But to have a newspaper
yeah.
that is so much relevant to these questions that are becoming so much in the mind of so many people,
yes.
there would be an avenue, or one would think they would use it in the business world, a market for, in the intellectual sense,
uh-huh.
for a newspaper of that quality. Like, do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, I understand what you're saying. I mean,
yeah.
In terms of being able to move a print edition
yeah.
nationally, there's a lot of logistical
challenges. I'll bet. Yeah, there would be. Yeah, sure.
And so our focus as far as expanding print circulation
yeah.
Has been here in New York. And we've been really fortunate. In the last 6 months, we've had some funders step forward That
I would think there'd be a number of people who would want to help you out that way.
You know, reader support has always been our number one financial source.
And then
with advertising following.
Yeah, because it looks so good.
Yeah.
The paper looks, it's so well done.
So we've always had progressive advertisers, M&N, Democracy Now!, Haymarket Books, Brooklyn for Peace, Blue Stockings Cafe, and other venues.
The stock market and Chase Manhattan Bank.
They haven't.
You get them subscribing, you're going to really be in business, I think. You know?
Yeah, well, they haven't been knocking on our door.
No, they haven't knocked on your door, right?
We're not knocking on their door either.
Okay, right.
We've always had a certain amount of subscriber advertisers of a progressive bent, but our number one, financial. A funding source has been our readers who give every year in our fund drive, subscribers. We have people who are monthly sustainers who sign up on our website and send us, $5 or $10 or $20 a month. And then over the summer, we had a couple of people step forward who really love the paper and have some of the same reaction that you do to it, who wanted to help us expand our circulation, because as they told me that, we think what you're doing is amazing, but we want more people to see it and read it. So they've really put their money where their mouth is, and they've helped us be able to purchase street boxes that we're now able to put out at different subway stops around the city. We got wire racks in more and more libraries and other cultural venues. Mm-hmm. And we hope to double our circulation by next spring here in New York City. These same people have also provided the resources so that we can redesign our website. We're going to have a more visually attractive website, but also a website that's fully mobile compatible, because more people are on the smartphones.
Yeah.
More and more people, that's where people are getting their news and keeping up with things. And then that website's also going to be fully interfaced with all our social media platforms. So we're really excited about that we're going to be growing both on print and online.
Yeah.
You know, they're both. Both formats are important.
Trying to keep up on both. Uh-huh. And what about in multimedia talking? Like, we're in multimedia here. Television is the thing we had. I can remember when there was no television at all. No television. Didn't exist.
I can remember there wasn't internet, but you.
No, there was no television when I was a lad. I mean, they had to discover it and build it up, and now it's become very important. And multimedia is.
So you
important.
Probably would have grown up with like radio and fireside chats.
We had Jack Benny and Phil Harris, and the Hit Parade and that kind of stuff.
Yeah, media is constantly evolving.
It is, and there was, that's something true. The media, and Marsha McLuhan wrote really well on it. Mm-hmm. James Joyce was very sensitive to the importance of the media, too.
Okay.
But in media, multimedia is coming, and the exponential increasing of the capability is just going, it's not arithmetic, the growth of the, Ray Kurzweil and or Diamantes and that. It's growing exponentially.
Here's the thing,
Yes, sir.
Is as our media platforms grow and grow and grow, there's still only 24 hours in a day.
That's true.
And people only have so much wavelength, as we say sometimes now.
Right.
And I think that's where having high quality product is really key.
I wish they had more high quality. We've got, if I may,
because people only have so much time in a day. So you
true.
Really like we really try I to ensure we thing, ensure saw, that when yeah. people pick up this paper, they feel like okay. This is going to be worth my while to read some articles.
Well, I was
in
trying
paper.
To say whether you can get into multimedia. The paper is good. That's linear. That's print. That's all that. That's really good, and you're doing it. And I just take my hat off to you enormously.
Yeah.
But there is this question of multimedia. It seems to be coming along, and everything, and whether or not there could be that, and it can be done. I saw a thing about Nova. They have things that are done that are so staggeringly interesting and educational in the best sense of the word.
Mm-hmm.
They put it together artfully, and it's a big skill and everything about teaching the store of human knowledge.
Uh-huh.
We're coming to know everything more and more about everything.
Yes.
And that the multimedia is a way. We're in multimedia here.
Uh-huh.
Have you thought about trying to have some sort of a way of involving like a multimedia presence within the context of your educational role of helping to have understanding important to the transformation of the society, to the benefit of the society, out of the public wheel, if you understand it, to get into multimedia in some way or other, or how there should be an alliance between public access. You say you have that across the country. There were 4,000 public access facilities like this across the country. Yes. There could be a link into public access multimedia existing. We've got Amy Goodman, we've got other people that have done some of that, but do you understand what I'm saying? Get involved in the multimedia part of the overall mission of educating people generally to what's going on.
Yes.
Do you understand what I'm saying? Or maybe that's just reaching too far, or for somebody who's, well, and it would have grown out of the newspaper.
But, sure. I mean,
and do you have any books or expanded treatments of certain subjects? Richard Wolff could write books on economics. Okay, I'm sorry, I've just got off on a kind of.
No,
you understand
great,
what
it's
I'm
great
saying?
You're excited about these ideas. Yeah. We're experimenting.
Yeah.
We've experimented with SoundCloud, with
what is SoundCloud?
It's a platform where you can essentially post audio files.
Audio files,
okay. Sort of almost like podcasty kind of material. So we've experimented with that a little bit. We experimented with doing photo galleries on our website to go accompany certain articles.
Mm-hmm.
We'd like to get into maybe developing little video clips that could run on the website with an article where, if we're already out doing the interviews and the reporting, get some video footage, maybe of our reporter talking with a source that we could, use to sort of complement the print article. We have had, discussions with WBAI about how some of our material could
they're
be.
They're radio.
Yeah, they're radio. They've expressed.
That's what Marshall McLuhan. Uh-huh. Remember Marshall McLuhan? He was a major, the oracle of the electronic age.
Right.
And he was writing on that, and he said that would have been what they call a hot medium, a high definition of one of your century ratios.
Okay.
As opposed to a cool medium that is one that involves the way we experience. Uh-huh. The world as we walk through it.
Mm-hmm.
It's multi-sensorial, multimedia is a different kind of medium, and it's a different way of educating people. It involves a lot of skill sets and things like that, or education.
Sure.
And then the whole subject areas of all the education could be much more put into. They had a thing in England called the leadership, I forget what they called it. Walter Perry was the head of it. It was education. You got Harvard, you've got Eton and Harrow, Oxford, Cambridge, all mm-hmm. that. They got an intellectual. But they had a thing where they were trying to take the store of human knowledge and use multimedia presentations to educate the people of England.
Okay.
And they tried to get it over here in the United States, and they got all kinds of blowback from the professors across the country who didn't want to have a competition from the leading voices in each of the fields to their role of authority within the classroom.
Uh-huh.
But anyway, multimedia seems to be important. I don't know if there's a chance of getting it into a wider way of reaching the public or something. Maybe I'm off on a different tack because we're in television.
Sure, right? It's great, and it's great to be here.
Yeah.
For us, there is a balancing act. I mean, we don't have a huge staff of people.
I wanted to ask you.
Well,
that.
Our human resources are limited, mm-hmm. and so there's a balance between trying to experiment and expand, onto the internet, into social media, podcasting, potentially video activity, with also the fact that staying true to what we do best.
Yeah. Fair enough. Yeah.
Our core activity is publishing a newspaper, is the reporting and writing and editing that goes into that. So that's what we do best. That's
what
we have the largest.
We want you to turn out multimedia Academy Award winning blockbuster films, with all kinds of. No, I'm just making a joke. I got carried away with it.
Yeah.
But it's just that the more it's moving along and there's possibilities and everything.
Yeah,
and
how and we're many trying to be, how many you know, people mindful
are
of that.
There? How many are there writing? You have people doing artwork and all of that. What's the overall structure of it? And are you having an invitation out to people who might be interested in sending in a contribution or some contributing in the general public and everything? Mm-hmm. Are there letters to the editors to follow up? Uh-huh. You know what I'm saying?
Sure. So we have two full-time staff. We have several other part-time staff. We have sort of a network of contributing writers.
Mm-hmm.
They all play a role in shaping the paper that you see each month.
Yeah, and then you have the writing talent and the minds that are writing the articles and everything.
We have people that participate in the paper that are fairly new to journalism. They're sort of feeling their way, and we try to mentor.
You think journalism,
mentor and
support.
You don't
think yourself university or underground university or something.
There is a teaching element to what we do.
Yeah, there is,
sure. And we've always been proud of that. And we've helped train and mentor many, many people who've gone on to other, areas in journalism, and then the Indypendent was sort of a starting point for them, including people that have, gone on to the New York Times, NBC News, but also Democracy Now.
They're going to be abandoning New York Times and those stodgy old places to try and get an article in the Independent soon, because the quality of what you're turning
out. And we've had a lot of people.
And the relevance of what
you're turning out. Yes, we've had a lot of people that started
the Indy. I'm making a joke in a way.
Yeah. But sure, we've had people that have started at the Indy and gone in all directions and have done great work, many of them in other progressive media outlets, as well as some people going on to, legacy larger outlets, and we're proud of all of them.
Yeah.
We do have a mentoring role to many people that's just sort of making their way into journalism. We also have people who write for us who, already have the skills and see the Independent as an outlet that they want to be contributing to. We have a number of professors at the City University of New York who write for us who are. When we're looking for more analytical pieces on a given subject. We have a real range of people who write for us. We have people in various parts of the world. We've had, not just New York coverage. I mean, we've had people do original reporting for us from, Latin America, Middle East, Europe, et cetera.
Like stringers, huh?
People who are...
People who have an interest,
Who have real knowledge and are on the ground.
And they're connected to you through the internet largely then? If somebody in another part of the world, I mean?
Yeah, you can, sure.
We've, yeah.
I mean, we're all interconnected now.
Right, isn't it?
Electronically,
something?
At least. And keep tabs on various, sites where, people's material comes up. And, I see someone who's, doing good work and want to try to see if they write for the Independent. I can, often find them on Facebook or Twitter.
Your editor, is that it? Is that your role or your title? Do you have a title?
Yes, editor.
And you've been there from the beginning of this. I mean, it was when you didn't turn it off on a mimeograph by hand.
No mimeographs.
We did that in the old days.
Yeah.
But everything. But you did it from the beginning. You must feel a sense of pride. I can remember at the beginning it was not nearly as impressive as it has become, and I congratulate you on the growth and the quality and quantity of your effort. You must feel pretty good about that, I would think.
Yeah, it's gratifying to see how far we've come, and I think what's most gratifying is that this has been a labor that, literally hundreds of people have participated in. It's been a huge collective endeavor.
I mean, crowdsourcing.
This is the Independent's been a magnet that's drawn all sorts of people in who've made real contributions, and we've had hundreds and hundreds of writers write for us. There's probably been scores of people that have really at one time or another dedicated a substantial part of their lives to helping build the paper. I've been there pretty much from the get-go. I see myself as having helped facilitate a larger collective process that the paper has been successful because of being able to mobilize our collective power to produce something like, produce the paper, to build the distribution networks that we've built, mm-hmm. To build the networks of writers. This is, it's really amazing. One person can do a lot, but many people working in concert toward a larger goal can do much more, and I think our paper is proof of that.
Yeah, and you grow.
Yes.
I mean, you grow in quantity and quality as you succeed with the effort of people, and so there's pride in that. Do you have more people submitting things to you they would like you to print than you're able to manage, or do you get people from the academic community or from other parts of the world who would send
we get unsolicited submissions, and I mean sometimes we like what we see and do use it in the newspaper or on the website. Other times the material isn't quite relevant to what we're looking to talk about.
Uh-huh.
But we appreciate that people are thinking of us, and we also, like I said, we also do our own soliciting and reaching out to writers and thinkers and sometimes I will reach out to somebody and be like, would you be interested in writing about, this topic, next month? What do you think? Or sometimes I just throw out a feeler like, we're interested in this. What's your take on it? And start a conversation with a writer.
Yeah.
And if we find that there's sort of a mutual interest in developing an article, then we move from there.
Do you have like the Times has people that are on the page, you used to have columnists and things like that. Is there anything like that of people who anchor the thing, and like the New York Times has on their editorial page, major writers that people come to depend upon for? Do you understand what
I know what you're saying.
Or if you don't have that? Or
We don't really have an op-ed page with those kind of figures.
We do have
individuals who written for us over a number of years that are
they build
sort
up
of
a following, maybe, if they say
some of our writers, Nicholas Powers, Stephen Wishnia. I mean, I've written a number of articles over the years, and there's been many other people who've written a number of times for us that I think would be familiar to our readers. But no, we don't have like a formal op-ed page with.
Do you think you could ever get an article in there from, let's say, Bernie Sanders or Amy Goodman or somebody that's in the public knowledge across the world or something like that, or a senator or somebody who's got an issue that they want to have be aware of? Do you understand what I mean?
Uh-huh.
It, people like that who are in the public domain but in a major way, major voices in that? That would want to publish in your newspaper for whatever reason they would want to do that, or you would want to have them do it? And would you be then touching into territory that would be outside of a canon of political thinking that you don't want to give any credence to anybody who's so crass as to be a senator of the United States or something? Do you understand what I'm saying? Or a governor or something? You know what I'm saying? Because the issues you're talking about are now not just in a small group of people in a... what I'm saying? It's the issues that are motivating the thinking of just vast numbers of people in the society, even some of the political leaders.
Yeah, I mean, we certainly wouldn't rule out contributions.
If the president wanted to say a little piece in there, you'd take it, right?
You want to vet it
for purity or something? No, you understand what I'm saying, right?
Yeah, but on the other hand...
That would be getting into the society in general outside of a relatively small view of things political, which would be... Do you understand what I'm saying?
I feel like we have access to writers who can talk about, important issues in a way that's, relevant and meaningful to... tens of thousands of people. If Bernie Sanders wanted to write something for us, of course we'd be very interested in that. But he has platforms.
Yeah, but they're going to be looking for platforms similar to yours.
Okay.
Because where are there platforms they can appear? They can appear in the New York Times or something if the editorials will deign to have it or something.
Uh-huh.
But there's others, and there's, there would be a place for it to go.
Uh-huh.
And the quality speaks for itself of the effort you're doing.
Sure. So, like I said, we certainly wouldn't rule out contributions from, super prominent individuals that would happen.
Even if they're part of the establishment.
Again, if they have something important and relevant to say that we'd want to share with
you
our
know
readers.
What I, you know what
but
I'm saying.
But let me. The thing I want to say is that you know I think our success has been in drawing out the voices from below. And elevating and amplifying
right,
them
because right, yeah,
this
right,
world
right.
is full of people yeah. that have really interesting, important things to say,
right.
stories to share
right.
that largely gets overlooked in our media system.
Yeah, right. Okay.
And,
yeah.
and our you know our emphasis is more on elevating and amplifying voices from below, from you know communities that are traditionally ignored or marginalized in the media.
And realize a lot of the people that had the best things to say were ignored in their own time, and you want to get some of those people before they're gone, if you know what I mean.
Sure.
Mozart was buried in a pauper's grave.
Okay.
And some of the great voices have not had a voice ever,
mm-hmm.
and they were not, they weren't allowed to have a voice because mm-hmm. there was no place for them to voice something that, you know, when they first came out and they said Galileo had that problem, didn't he?
Mm-hmm.
He said that we weren't the center of the universe and it messed up everybody's sense of identity, and they didn't want to hear that. They put
right.
him in jail.
Mm-hmm.
But he should have been heard.
Mm-hmm.
Do you understand?
Sure.
Something like that.
You
know what I'm saying.
I think so. And one of the things I've been proud of is over the years, I mean, our paper has often talked about subjects, talked about movements
right.
before they really became prominent.
Because that's what I'm trying to say.
Because
yeah.
we were listening to and drawing from.
Exactly. Ears and, out for something new and
yeah.
interesting and relevant in a systems
and,
way. Yeah, that's what we need.
I mean, I was flipping through some very old issues sometime in the past year, and I came across an article, for example, that one of our writers wrote like in 2002 about the difficulties that transgender people face in bathroom access.
Right, right.
Well, this was in 2002.
Yeah, now it's
we didn't
all
even
old.
Have we yeah. didn't even have gay marriage then.
Right, right, right.
And you know, so transgender rights, for example, really come into the forefront
right
in the last
you
year
are.
Or two.
Right, but, you are. Yeah.
I mean, we had somebody talking about that a dozen years in advance, or we had
yeah.
people, before Occupy Wall Street, months in advance of that. I mean,
uh-huh.
we covered. People who were sleeping out on the sidewalk
yeah.
outside of City Hall protesting budget cuts that were,
uh-huh.
you know, affecting libraries and fire departments. And these same people who organized these
right.
small protests
right.
that we were the only outlet in the city covering
yeah,
them.
Right.
I
yeah.
mean, I went and slept out on the sidewalk with them for a couple of nights. And so we did coverage of them. Well, these were the same people 3 months later. In the
time of the year that you slept on the sidewalk? Was it
June.
July or was it,
it was
June?
It was June of 2001.
It wasn't January.
No.
With snowbanks.
No.
No.
But the
no,
thing,
I'm just playing with
sure,
you.
Sure, of course.
Yeah, yeah.
But these same people who organized this small, it was called Bloombergville. And it was anywhere.
That, I wanted to ask you about humor, you know,
yeah.
too. Yeah. We got
so,
to use humor, yeah.
Yeah, so, I mean, this was, you know, this was a protest of anywhere from 50 to 200 people that took
that's,
place on a sidewalk
a,
outside
a
of city,
people, yeah.
outside
yeah.
of City Hall over several weeks in the summer of 2011. We were
yeah.
the only, you know, media outlet in the city practically that was covering them.
Yeah.
And the other media outlets were across the street talking
yeah.
to the mayor and the city council people
yeah.
and didn't have any time for these, you know, scruffy protesters. Well, these
right.
same protesters
yeah.
that did Bloombergville,
yeah.
many of those were the same people that would later launch Occupy Wall Street
right.
in Zuccotti
right.
Park.
So right, right, yeah.
Anyway,
yeah.
so.
Yeah.
You know, before people in the New York Times or CNN heard about these people at Occupy Wall Street and Zuccotti Park, the readers of The Independent were hearing from these
right.
people when they
yeah.
were doing the same thing at Bloombergville.
Yeah, right,
and,
right,
and,
right.
And I think that's been the case with our coverage many times
Do
over the year.
Do you think it's
year.
Possible to become, oh, go ahead, sorry. Yeah.
And the same thing, we did an issue in November of 2002
yeah.
called Why War, Why Now?
Yes, when, right, exactly. I'd like to bring that question
when,
up
when
always.
When President yeah. Bush and the Congress and all the corporate media were banging the drums to go to war,
yeah.
we published a whole 20-page issue, you know, essentially
of the Independent.
Yeah,
yeah okay.
on this subject and
yeah,
deconstructing it,
yeah.
looking at all, you know, the false rationales, the what the other motives might
it's
be.
It's curriculum, your newspaper, sir.
Yeah, we had
one
supporter of our paper called it the largest political education project
yeah,
in the
exactly.
city.
Exactly, that's exactly
so,
what I'm thinking.
You
yeah.
know, when people
yeah.
like, you know, Hillary Clinton.
Mazel tov, as they say in the Yiddish, yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
But anyway, so, you know, when you think so much of our political establishment marched off to war,
yeah.
Many of them deluded.
As they have down through the ages.
You
yeah.
know, I mean, readers of the Indypendent were getting an entirely different perspective, and that's something
bless you, yeah.
Yeah, continued to provide over the years.
Yeah, we need it. We need it. We need the artists and the people to do that. What about humor? Do you get have you got some cut-ups with you? Michael Moore does so much with his thing, you know, and everything. And or what's the guy on television? Humor or cartoonist and stuff that. Are you trying to get into some of that?
Well, we've always. A really important part of the paper to us has always been the visual side of the paper.
Yeah, I know. It looks great.
Both in terms of design, photography, and we've also, for most of our history, had illustrations that accompany some of our articles.
Yeah.
We've had an illustration coordinator, Frank Reynoso, who's been with us for 13 years now, and he's built up a whole roster of contributing illustrators.
Good.
We have like a serious article, but we have an illustration that goes with it that might, makes a point, but also makes people laugh.
Yeah, right.
So the illustrations really, I think, have helped leave in the paper. We try to sometimes make the headlines, you know, puns or other ways of, you know, injecting an element of humor. And also recently we brought on board advice columnist, Reverend Billy. I don't know if you're familiar.
Oh, Reverend Billy's an old friend of mine. We went into a place down there. He was just getting started, just came to town. Talon, isn't his name Talon?
Yeah, Billy.
Yeah,
Billy,
great Talon. Guy. And he's a reverend, and he had a thing. He went into a 7th Avenue, and this is 1,000 years ago. Just getting started, a young fellow then, and everything. And we walked into a store, and I'm in there with him, and I like people. And he's got Mickey Mouse or something. He walks in the store, Mickey Mouse is the enemy. It was so funny.
Yeah.
It was a riot and everything. That's theater. Theater. God bless Judith Malina and the Living Theater, and all those people have been in a theatrical thing and everything.
Yeah, so Billy's been a friend of the
paper. I love Billy. Yeah.
Yeah, he's been a friend of the paper.
The Church of Stop Shopping?
Yes.
Yeah, right.
So, Billy's been a friend
of the paper. He dressed like a reverend.
Yes.
Yeah. See, that's funny. That's really good.
Yes, he's
is he part of your crew?
Well,
he's a fellow traveler.
Sure, he's been a friend for many years. And, we help promote some of his performances. I mean, he's going to be at Joe's Pub later this month. And he's also now our spiritual advice columnist. And he is tremendous. He's able to be both serious and funny at the same time.
Right. So thank goodness. You gotta laugh some, you know. Yeah.
So we'll have Billy his advice column in every issue now.
Is he really? Okay.
Yeah.
Advice for the right.
And
Reverend Billy.
I think by the time we by the time we get to the end of the selection cycle, I think we're all going to need some consolation, whatever happens. And, we've had people like, Billy's been a great friend, figures, I mean, people like Naomi Klein, Jeremy Scahill.
We were going to try to get a clip in. I don't think we can do it. I'm sorry. Mm. They've
been wonderful supporters over the years. So, it's a paper that, I think really organically comes out of the experiences of people in this city and elsewhere, and we really try to give that a voice. But we also are a platform for, some really, prominent thinkers on the left.
And yeah, right.
So we try to, sort of incorporate all of that, and then inject an element of humor with someone like Reverend Billy. We're gonna start having a regular food page.
Randy Credico is funny. Yeah, there's a lot of people. Yeah, funny is really good.
We're gonna start to have some regular food
coverage.
You don't
want to be too overly serious.
No,
maybe. That a problem, do you think, with people who get too serious on a particular thing and can't talk to anybody except those that are just on one small part of the third patria of Marx or something?
Yeah, sure.
And you know what I'm saying? And get too seriously? What do you think?
Yeah, we've always tried to.
You've got to keep the sense of humor. And does that mean also some outreach to others in the society who maybe aren't as onto what you're doing as they will become?
Sure.
Outreach to the people who are thinking more conventionally, perhaps. And
that's why we.
Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I was saying earlier in the interview.
You got a chance to do that with your vehicle, yeah.
Yeah, no, what I was saying earlier in the interview is part of the reason we created a newspaper was to have a platform where we could be in dialogue with people, from various
levels of society.
Levels of society, because a website can tend to attract a very sort of self
That's right.
Self-fulfilling.
And you keep
audience.
It up, and you're pretty soon you're going to have a regular article by the President of the United States. You know, you're going to be able to. You know what I'm saying? You're
well,
gonna be getting,
I,
yeah, no,
I
mean,
think we'd rather
a recognition, maybe. off the.
That's not what you know. That's not what we're really looking
outreach,
for.
Outreach to everybody. Uh-huh. You know, rather than get narrow.
Sure. Anybody who's got an open mind.
Yeah, and, open-minded.
And you know, we had an issue last month where we covered the gig economy.
Yeah.
And all these people are going to work for Uber or TaskRabbit or you know other people like that. Yeah. And if you look at that issue, I mean, we really feature the voices of just ordinary working people that are trying to make extra money in this very difficult situation.
Wonderful, wonderful.
And I think anybody, you know, whatever their political ideology might be, would read that and see element of their life in it.
Very, very, very well said, young man. Very well said, and
congratulations
to you and the whole gang over there. And we all here at MNN wish you all the very best. And we thank you in the audience for viewing in. It's John Tarleton. He's the editor, as you can see, editor and co-founder of The Indypendent, a free paper for a free people. And you can see the site is spelled with a Y, you see. Go to it. It's a major source, and I may you grow. And I think what you're doing is magnificent, and I applaud you very, very much, and just wish you all the very best with everything you've done. I'm glad we got together 10 years ago. We're going to try and get to that tape someday and get that up as well. But thanks a lot for coming in, and all the very best.
Yes, and congratulations on your show, too. 40 years and still going.
Well, 45, yeah. Yeah, it just keeps going, yeah. Okay, thank you for viewing. We'll be coming back again, tomorrow. So do tune in. And John, thanks a lot for all the work and for leading such a very, 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 very well-led life. Okay.
Well, thank you, Harold.
My pleasure. Thank you for viewing. Now, smile to the audience. You see? Okay. So, anyway, we got a lot in. I don't know if you get a lot more and everything, but okay. So, thanks.
Fun.
Fun and everything. Would anything quick? Maybe it would be on the outtake or anything more?
I wish you could have used I
yeah,
forgot about
the
tape.
Yeah, we forgot the damn tape. Yeah, it was too rushed. I'm sorry we didn't get it in with Naomi Klein. Mm-hmm. And Scahill, they're great people. They've supported you, and their voice should be in support of you as well. Yeah, yeah, they're part of the whole thing.
There's no way to do a little cut in with them afterwards.
No, I don't think so. No, I can't. We have to do another program. Okay, let's try to think about doing another program.
Okay.
Yeah, let's do a regular thing. You know. Mm. Anyway, I don't know. There's still. I think we should be out, right? So. And we got to get another program done here, okay?
Yes.
So let's don't forget to unmic yourself.
Oh yeah.
So. Careful,
you're
still
right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, honey.
Yeah.
All right. Time or not?
Yeah. You're down.
Okay. What time?